Last week, I applied this aphorism to America, arguing that much of America's history constituted hard times creating strong people who in turn created good times. Those good times, however, lasted more than long enough for Americans to get so used to a high level of national security and wealth, and so distant from threats to either, that as a nation, America became arrogant and aloof. More and more Americans were less and less concerned about doing the things that gave this nation its strength in the first place. In this video, I'm going to argue that this path to decadence was completely predictable, if not all but inevitable. But before I get into that, I want to clarify a misunderstanding that I managed to walk right into myself. I really like the hard times aphorism that we started off with on the screen in this video. I believe it's an excellent distillation of a type of cyclical cultural pattern that can happen in long-standing social groups like families, tribes, and countries. However, in using it, I have invited some to think that I'm some sort of authoritarian right-winger or full-blown traditionalist. Neither of these things are true. I consider myself to be moderate right, and I have respect for various traditions, and I think we shouldn't be too hasty in making big changes to long-standing institutions. As I often say, just as in genetics, in the world of culture, most mutations are not improvements. But sometimes traditions do need to be changed. Maybe they weren't the best idea after all, and the new idea actually is better. This does happen. Or maybe they were a fantastic way of doing things, but the world has changed. Just as in evolutionary biology, when an ecosystem changes, all bets are off as to how well adapted organisms are going to be in this new changed ecosystem as compared to how they were prior to the change. Things like technological advances, things like telecommunications and mass transportations, these have had profound impacts in the way humans live their lives, how they relate to each other. And so it's to be expected that not every single idea that was relatively effective in, say, 1910 is going to continue to be effective in this new world that we have created for ourselves. And as such, we have to be open to making changes. I don't think we should be hasty because, you know, what are the odds that your new idea is better than the old one? You know, that there won't be unintended consequences of making the changes, that the things that you're thinking of removing, maybe they're serving functions that are super important, but you don't realize they're being served. G.K. Chesterton's fence comes to mind. A lot of these ideas I'm bringing up here are initially I got from Jordan Peterson, who I have mixed feelings about, to say the very least. Anyhow, I guess what this is meaning to communicate is, yes, I am moderate. There are benefits and burdens to staying still and to changing. There are risks and potential rewards. And so we need to be open-minded without being hasty. Anyhow, back to your regularly scheduled program, the current video. For America, the World Wars were the last time that this country has experienced anything remotely close to an all-hands-on-deck type situation. It wasn't just those in the armed forces that were rising to this challenge. Women back home were working jobs ordinarily held by the male soldiers. During World War I, alcohol was temporarily prohibited so as to make more grains available for food production. This, incidentally, was also done by 9 Confederate states during the Civil War for the same reason. Americans were purchasing war bonds to fund the war effort, and somewhat analogous to how some American companies during the early stages of COVID were redirecting their efforts towards producing things like masks and hand sanitizer. Back during the wars, there was a reorientation of segments of the domestic economy towards producing things like military technology and other things that the soldiers would need. So really, all hands were on deck, and in a way that we haven't seen probably since then. During the post-World War II economic boom, America quickly rose to become the world's richest, most powerful, and influential nation. And while the war was over, America still had to maintain vigilance for the next handful of decades due to the ever-looming threat of the USSR during the Cold War. Interestingly, America's economic boom and the vigilance with respect to the Soviet Union were not unrelated. The American government invested heavily in the development of technologies useful to the military, and some of these would go on to become mainstream. Notable examples include GPS, digital cameras, memory foam, mobile phone technologies, virtual reality, and of course, this very internet that we're talking on right now. But here's where things started to shift. After the Cold War petered out in 91, with the exception of the scare induced by 9/11, Americans really have not had much to worry about in terms of homeland security. But before I go into the subsequent decline, let's take a look at the sort of tribal dynamics that I'm invoking here, taking it right back to their very evolutionary origins. Prior to the evolution of modern humans, our primate ancestors lived in African rainforests. Our ancestors were very well adapted to this ecosystem. There were all sorts of predator animals that were stronger and faster than our ancestors, but our ancestors had the advantage of being able to climb up trees so as to stay away from these predators. And we could also hide very effectively given all the trees, bushes, and all that stuff, you know, the dense forest and forest canopy, all that good stuff. For reasons that I can only speculate, our ancestors eventually made their way into the open savanna. This was very risky, as there were relatively few trees for them to climb up when predators were around, and few trees and no forest canopy to keep them hidden. Because our pre-human ancestors were relatively weak and slow compared to the predators we were dealing with, we couldn't do well dealing with them one-on-one, and as such, there was a potent selective pressure emerging wherein tribes whose members were relatively good at cooperating with each other would have a huge advantage. What would unfold next, to make a slight aside, is what I think makes shows like The Walking Dead so compelling. In the early days of The Walking Dead, the primary threat, of course, was the zombies, the walkers. However, as the show progressed, the protagonist Neo tribe of humans soon became so adept at dealing with the zombies that they were barely even afraid of them anymore. But unfortunately, in a newly fallen world that had no established order and was nothing but chaos, it wouldn't take long for a new, far more potent threat to emerge. Other humans. Returning to our evolutionary story, anthropologists speculate that something similar to this happened in our ancestry. Our increasing social cognitive sophistication seemed to have been initially coaxed primarily by non-human threats. However, once that train left the station and was helping to neutralize non-human threats, a sort of social cognitive evolutionary arms race would take root between tribes, as our pre-human ancestors would increasingly become their own primary existential threat. Disproportionately, the tribes who survived would be those whose members were particularly good at communicating and cooperating with each other. So, right from the start, it would seem that our ancestors needed a serious threat in order to come together and to fire on all cylinders. And given the incredible cognitive and neurological complexity of our advanced social cognitive abilities, along with the costs of housing them, big heads increasing the risk of to mothers during childbirth, the high nutritional requirements of such a large, busy brain, and so forth, evolutionarily speaking, there is no way that these capacities could have emerged without a strong, sustained, selective pressure. As another brief aside, a very compelling interpretation of the story of the fall in Genesis in the Bible is that when Adam and Eve ate the apple from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, this was a symbolic representation of the development of humans' higher order cognition. Things like theory of mind, that is recognizing that others have minds too, social cognition, introspection, and the ability to conceive of and then plan for the future. One who cannot conceive of others as having minds cannot be held morally responsible because they can't possibly engage in anything but amoral behavior. But once humans become aware that others are sentient, morality for the first time becomes a thing. Secondly, our ability to conceive of the future makes us aware of our own vulnerability. It's no accident that immediately after eating the apple, Adam and Eve became aware of their own nakedness and proceeded to immediately cover up. This has been taken by some as a symbolic representation of humans becoming aware of their own vulnerability And awareness of one's vulnerability would then subsequently create the need to prepare for the future. As such, Adam's punishment was that he would have to till the field for the rest of his days. Since he couldn't count on nature to provide for him, he had to become a farmer in order to guarantee his own ongoing food supply. The punishment to Eve, of course, was the pain during childbirth that would be caused by the new bulbous head that is required to house a brain capable of all of this sophistication. Returning, a foundational element of evolutionary theory that I've already invoked is that species evolve in the context of their ecosystems. Organisms that have features that are well suited for a given ecosystem will tend to do better in it than organisms whose features are less fitting. If the environment is radically changed, however, all bets are off in terms of how well any of these organisms will do. So, bringing it back, what happens when we substantially remove the very impetus that drove higher order social cognition in humans, i.e. serious existential threats that called for intensive tribal collaboration? What happens when there are never barbarians at the gates? I think we are seeing what happens. The incredibly robust economic and military security of America and other Western nations has given us the freedom to increasingly take our foot off the gas. Thanks to our outsourcing, labor specialization, work easing, technology, broad availability of sedentary entertainment, like watching this video for example, and a voluntary military that comprises well under 0.5% of our population, Americans have gotten weaker. Our economic security has freed us to not encourage our young to develop their intellectual and physical capacities the way that we would encourage them to develop them if we were not so secure. As such, American kids are less fit than they used to be, they are plummeting in international rankings on academic testing, and countries like China, India, Russia, and Iran, among others, are blowing the US out of the water when it comes to churning out STEM grads. In addition to expecting less of ourselves and each other, we are also fragmenting as collectives. Our national wealth, the incredible ease of mobility afforded to us by our modern technology, the mass movement of women into the workforce, something that initially was an option for most, but has quickly become mandatory for most due to the wage-depressing effect of nearly doubling the labor force. All of this has facilitated single parenthood, divorce, father delinquency, the spatial disintegration of families, whether they be intact or not. And more communities now, they really are communities in name only. They are so transient, with neighbors constantly cycling through. You know, really they seem to be communities in name only. All of this has had seriously deleterious effects on the rearing of children and on the mental health of people of all ages and with respect to our social cohesion and ability to trust and depend on and support each other. To be clear, I am not necessarily speaking against all of these developments. It's good, you know, for us that our nation is wealthy. Individual liberties of people regardless of their sex is something also that I will stridently defend. Moving on, sometimes divorce is the best option. And I myself have moved long distances in search of better weather, lower cost of living, better work opportunities, and the like. But all of these things are luxuries afforded to us by an affluent, secure society. My intention here is merely to point out some of the social costs of these things, though not denying their benefits nor their legitimacy. To give a non-American example of the sort of dynamics just discussed, consider South Korea, Taiwan, Singapore, and Hong Kong, collectively referred to as the Asian Tigers in reference to their rapid economic growth since the 60s. These countries have reported unprecedentedly high divorce rates over the past 50 years. All of this, of course, was concurrent with increased female labor participation, increased car ownership, and greatly improved local and national public transportation. And international transportation too, for that matter. Returning to America and national security, since we have had so little to be afraid of since the end of the Cold War, we have been permitted to loosen our commitments to each other. Imagine if China, or some alien invader, were to come in and start barraging and trying to kill all Americans. We would drop the culture war incredibly quickly. We would move back to be with our family, you know, who we left. We would start coming back together so fast that you would think it was instinctual. Alternatively, imagine if the residents of another neighborhood started attacking your neighborhood. You'd start getting to know your neighbors pretty much immediately. There would be community meetings and you would actually go to them. So let's start wrapping this up. Right from the dawn of humanity itself.
And then this monkey fish frog had butt sex with that monkey, and that monkey had a mutant retard baby that screwed another monkey, and that made you.
Our ability to form tight, lasting, interdependent, cooperative bonds has been what has allowed us to survive and thrive in hard times. It is only incredible security that has allowed us to branch off from our tribes. In his book, The Righteous Mind, Jonathan Haidt describes research comparing working class and upper middle class people from the US and a developing nation. Interestingly, the wealthier people across countries had more in common with each other than they did with the poorer people in their own country. The wealthier people tended to prioritize Western individualist considerations of harm and fairness, whereas the poorer people valued these things in addition to more collectivist-oriented considerations such as abiding by norms of the group. So, to conclude, security has to be earned. Once earned, it can allow for increasing individualism. However, too much individualism and too little commitment to the collective can create weaker people and weaker ties between those people. And when that happens, we become increasingly vulnerable to other nations who are busy earning their security. You are here.
Hold on, wait a second. This is gay. This is really gay. Yeah, this is even gayer than all the men getting in a big pile and having sex with each other. Okay, sorry, my bad. Everyone back in the pile.
Back in the pile, everyone! We're going back to the pile.
Jump in!
Come on, everybody!
We're going back to the pile!
Yeah, come on!